Yes, all of that is true. But what I'm trying to compare and show you through the 7 days of creation is the 7 days of creation of the Christian life. How that thing coincides with your Christian life. This is what I mean. On day one, you get saved. That's almost like a baby being born, a new, brand new baby born into that family. But ladies and gentlemen, that's not all there is. There's not all there is. If all God wanted to do was save you, he'd have killed you right when he saved you. But if you're saved and you're still breathing, then God has some more days he wants to accomplish. What's the old song we sung to B.I.B. Lee a while ago? And the, one of the other songs I remember in Sunday school was, he's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. And ladies and gentlemen, everybody in this room, I know maybe you looked in the mirror and you thought you looked pretty good, but I'm just here to tell you, the mirror lied to you, because God is still working on all of us.
Amen.
And it doesn't matter where you came from. It doesn't matter where you're headed. Ladies and gentlemen, God's still working on us. And the whole purpose, the whole idea is to move from day one. And God is working on us and working on us and getting us and perfecting us and making us into what he wants to be into day seven.
Amen.
The problem is, a lot of Christians, they get saved. They want a little fire insurance.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't want to move on to nothing else, because day two, day three, day four, day five requires me to do something.
Right.
Amen. Amen.
Day one, God does everything.
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
Salvation is, it won't cost you a dime. God did it all on the cross.
Woo,
hallelujah.
Amen.
But then day two, God says, all right, now let me see some growth from you.
Amen.
Day three, I want to see some fruitfulness from you.
Yeah.
Now we're on day number four. Let's go to, what verse is it? Verse 14. Here's day number four. And we talked about all of that. Last week we talked about being fruitful. That's where we saw things be bringing forth fruit on day three. Well, as a Christian, you ought to bring forth fruit. Now, let's look at what day four brings. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. And God set them in the firmament of the heaven. Firmament, all it is that outer space, that the expansion of space out there. Put them in the firmament of heaven to give light upon the earth. And to rule over the day and over the night. To divide the light from, notice, divide, divide, divide. Every day he's dividing something. He saves you on day one, and then on day two, he starts cutting away and dividing stuff off of you that don't belong there.
Right.
On day three, he starts cutting and dividing some more. On day four, he's still cutting and dividing.
Yeah.
So you thought when God saved you, you turned perfect. Well, I got news for you. You didn't.
Amen.
Ask your wife. Ask your husband. He divided the light from the darkness, and God saw that it was good, and the evening and the morning were the fourth day. Let's go to the Lord's word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for these days and what we're spiritually getting out of these particular days. And God, I just want to say thank you for saving us. But Lord, help our church. Help us as individuals, me as a pastor, and all through this whole building. Help us not to stay on day one. Help us to move and grow in grace and the knowledge of Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us do that. Get something from this service. In Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's people said,
amen. Amen.
In Romans chapter 12, I don't have this verse up, but in Romans chapter number 12, it says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, talking to saved people. He says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And then he says, and be not conformed to this world. That word conformed is sort of like taking a lump of clay and conforming it to something you want to make. And so what he says to us Christians, don't be conformed to the world. Don't be conformed to the world. Don't let the world conform and shape and mold your mind. But then, in Romans 8, Over there it says, and for whom he did foreknow, he did predestinate. Predestinate, that's not a bad word. He predestinated us to be conformed to the image of his dear son. Mm-hmm. So as a Christian, you can either be conformed to the world, which is bad, or he says, let me conform you. Let me mold and make you into so you look like Christ.
Amen.
Now, I don't have time to teach all of this, but here's what I want to say. You can be saved. Now let me say this. See if this don't make you scratch your head, because this is probably something you don't never hear regularly on the news or on the Christian television or radio. You can be saved and on your way to heaven and not be a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Now see, by the definite quietness in the room, some of you said, the word Christian means Christ-like. I know some saved people that ain't acting Christ-like.
Amen.
Yeah, they're saved. They have Jesus living in their heart, but they have all they got is day one Christianity.
Right. Amen.
All they got salvation. God says, I want to conform you. I want to make you look like Christ.
Amen.
You know, and I know you have this same way. And if you look at my sister Linda or Jamie, my brother, and Diane, my other sister, and my dad, and people say this. I had a friend of mine went to a funeral where my sister Diane was, and I wasn't there. And it was her father-in-law that passed away, and it was a fella that had went to the memorial service, and he lives in Jackson. We were constables together. He calls me on the phone, and he says, I know what you'd look like with her. He saw my sister. He said, man, that's Jeremy with her. Some people say, you know, my dad had a head full of hair, and somebody said, boy, you look, some of the things you say or some of the mannerisms that you do remind me of your dad. And you know, hey, I'm like.
Amen. Right. All right. Amen.
But if you're saved, shouldn't people come up to you and say, you look like Christ.
Yeah.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
Right.
You look like your father.
Yeah. Amen.
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 Yeah.
Amen.
That's what day four is about. You say, this day four, what is this thing about? Yes, I got saved on day one. But day number four, there is light that comes in that maybe you've never seen before. And I know what you're thinking. You're saying, well, I saw light come in on day one. God said, let there be light, and there was light. But day four, there's some other kind of light that comes on, and it's called sunlight and moonlight. And this is totally different than the light that was on day one. This is a revealing where Christ makes himself real to you and you see him in a different light that you've never seen before.
Amen.
You say, preacher, what are you talking about? I'm confused. All right, let me give you this example. A baby when he's born on day one. Normally, now I know there are some exceptions to this, but normally when everything goes right, they have two arms, two legs, they have two eyes, two ears, and they have a nose and a mouth and all of that, and that baby's looking around. And that baby don't know everything it has.
Right.
Right.
He got two hands and 10 fingers, and he ain't got a clue what him or her. He ain't got a clue what he's got.
Mm-hmm.
Now, eventually, as that baby grows, he figures out, well, if I bend my hand, I can pick up this. That's why they call it the terrible. Why? Because they start learning how to use some of the stuff they were born with.
Yeah.
And you're like, ooh, leave that alone. Stop picking that up. And they realize, yes, you put that bottle, and boy, they eventually, aren't it mothers? Isn't it wonderful when that baby can hold their own bottle? Well, I'll be glad when they can hold their own bottle. And boy, they said, oh, that's what them things are. They've had them all along. But they just learned how to use them. When you get saved, God gives you everything you need to serve Him. But I didn't know it when I got saved. Over time, I said, oh, that's what that verse meant. Oh, that's what I'm supposed to do here. Oh, yeah, this is all of that. you know. And you start learning, you say, oh yeah, look at that. Oh, I'm hungry spiritually. Oh, look at that.
Yeah.
Or start feeding on this.
Yeah.
You see.
Yeah.
Just like a little baby does. Just like this, just put her fingers up toward that baby. He was looking for something. That's the way I will be when we come to church. Maybe, boy, your favorite song comes on, and boy, you're like, boy, that's good. But that's what day four is all about, is growing in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Now, let me move on. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, okay, what does sunlight, moonlight, all of this, what's that got to do with the Christian life? Well, let me show you. Now, God said there to be light on day one. But on day number four, sunlight showed up. Now, Adam was created. If you were to go to Genesis 1:1, where we are, Adam, all the way through your Old Testament, I got a chart up there, shows this whole thing. From Adam all the way to Christ is 4,000 years. The Bible says in 2 Peter 3:8, beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing. That one day of the Lord is 1,000 years, 1,000 years, one day. Y'all ready? Y'all ready? Day one. From Adam, Genesis 1:1, all the way to Bethlehem, where Jesus showed up, was 4,000 years.
Amen.
Now, if a day of the Lord is 1,000 years, 1,000 years, one day, that means Christ showed up on day number. I'm about to enjoy my own preaching again. He shows up. Now, that doesn't mean that Jesus hadn't always been. He's always been. But he manifested himself to the world.
Amen.
When he was born into this world and light came into this world, different than when it was on day one, but 4,000 years later, you say, preacher, day of the Lord, 1,000 years, 1,000 years, one day. Hey, that means Jesus was born on the fourth day. You say, well, you don't like that one? Let me give you this one. Y'all remember a fellow by the name of Lazarus? Lazarus has been dead how many before Jesus showed up?
4 days. Yeah. Amen.
Jesus showed up on the what? The fourth day. Lazarus had been dead 4 days, and Jesus showed up.
Yeah, amen.
On the fourth. All right. I wish I had some Bible readers. Jesus tells the disciples, get in the ship, go to the other side. They get in the midst of a storm. The storm, the ship's about to go under. And Jesus comes unto the, shows up in the fourth watch of the night. Am I going to preach this by myself? All right, maybe you didn't like that. Okay. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Y'all with me?
Yeah.
Chapter 4.
Yeah.
In verse number 4, uh-huh. Jesus shows up to the woman at the well.
Yeah, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
You say, what happened on day? I got saved on day one. I got saved on day one. But there's been a time in my life where I'm reading, I'm studying, I'm looking, and Jesus just shows up in the middle of something, and I'm like, wow.
Amen.
It ain't that I got re-saved. I got saved on day one, but he's making himself known unto me.
Amen.
And bringing light into my life like never before.
Amen.
You said, preacher, I still ain't getting it. All right, let me see if the Apostle Paul can help you. Apostle Paul was saved. He wrote 13 books in the New Testament. I guess he was saved.
Amen.
Wrote 13 books in the Bible. I'm assuming he was saved. But this is what he said in Philippians. He said that I may know him. Paul, I thought you already was saved. I thought you already knew him. He said, yeah, I know him. He said, I just want to know him, know him.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, I'm saved. I want to know him in the power of his resurrection. You want to know him? All right. Remember in the Old Testament? Old Testament, the king threw three Hebrew boys in. Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. The king looked over and he says, there's three. I'm counting. And the fourth is the... I told you, he shows up on day four. All through the whole Bible. Now you're saying, ah, oh, that's a man made. Ain't a man in this world can put all that together.
Amen.
The fourth day. Here we go. Now, I got this verse up there. You're not going to believe this one. You got to see this one. Malachi chapter, take a guess. Four. Malachi chapter four. You with me? Verse number two. But unto you that fear my name shall the Son of right. Son is capitalized. If you've got a good Bible, Son is capitalized. And you're looking at it and you're going, Son is capitalized, and it's spelt wrong. You know, that thing is spelt right. It's talking about the Lord. That verse is talking about the Lord.
Amen.
But it's got it spelt wrong. I got a mistake in my Bible. He spelled it that way on purpose. The S-U, capital S-U-N, the Son of Righteousness. Why? Because it shows up on day four in Malachi chapter four.
Amen. Amen.
That's what God created on day four for you. And he says, I'm going to bring Jesus and he's going to appear and manifest himself in a perfect light to you like never before. Now, all of that. Go to that little screen where I got all of the feast and all of that. Yeah, remember all of this? Listen, I wish I had time. I'm going to write a book on all this some of these days. 7 days of creation. Day one, day two, we're on day four. Sunlight. Well, if all of this is true, which it should be, then it should match up with the 7 Jewish feasts. 7 Jewish feasts. And the 4th Jewish feast is the day of Pentecost. Well, now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, how's that going to go together? All right, fix and tell you. The first day of Pentecost, the first one they ever had, wasn't in Acts 2. It was in the Old Testament, in Exodus about 19. God says, Moses, come up on this mountain. I'm coming down to meet. I'm coming down to manifest. Moses, come up on this mountain,
yeah.
And I'm coming down there
to
talk to you. He gave you 10 commandments. You know the story, right? When Moses come down off that mountain, the people's like, whoo, Moses, where you been? You shining.
Yeah.
You got to put a veil on you. Moses says, man, I've been in the presence of God.
Amen.
And it was bright up there.
Amen.
Old Testament. Somebody came down and revealed himself. All right, maybe you didn't like that Old Testament. Let me get to the New Testament. In Acts chapter number 2, on the day of Pentecost, something comes down. The Holy Spirit of God comes down and baptized. Listen, I'm talking about on the day of Pentecost, something is revealed. The lights get turned on and something is manifested. And 3,000 people get saved by God's marvelous grace when God shows up. Yes. On the day of this Pentecost. There's a whole lot more I could say about the Mount of Transfiguration and all of this, but that 7th man of faith is Abraham. Now, you're thinking, okay, how in the world are you going to talk? Well, Abraham. Now, in the Old Testament, remember I told you, Jesus just showed up. He was in Bethlehem, but he's always been.
Right.
Yeah.
So when Jesus showed up in the Old Testament, he came in the form of the angel of the Lord. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. And you got to tell you, you have to come on Wednesday nights to get all that. But on Christmas in Bethlehem, when he came down, it was like God just he came to this earth and put flesh over himself so he could dwell among us. But in the Old Testament, he showed himself in the form of the angel of the Lord. Abraham was the first one to meet him. Abraham sitting at the house minding his own business. And the angel of the Lord came down in a... Abraham's already saved. Abraham's already believed God and that particular environment and under that particular system. But he met the angel of the Lord right then and there on a special occasion.
Amen.
Moses met the same one. The burning bush. You know who was talking through the burning bush? The angel of the Lord.
Amen.
All of that through that Old Testament. Now, we'll move on. Because if you go through that whole Bible and look at that thing. Now, let me hurry. 7 pieces of furniture in the tabernacle. Let's see if this matches up. All of it's matched up so far. Let's see. The fourth piece. First piece, you have the brazen altar. That barbecue pit where they sacrifice down. Then they go to that laver. That matches day two, where you wash your hands and feet, make sure you think. And then you go into that one piece of curtain. And on the right is a table of showbread. We talked about that last week, table of showbread. And then over here, on the left, is a golden lampstand. I got a picture of it. A golden lampstand. The only light in that whole room came from that. Okay. Day one, salvation. But there comes a time when I'm over there eating bread. I'm over there eating my bread, table of show bread, and all of a sudden the light comes on.
Amen.
And I say, man, they just put that verse in there. The light comes on. Said, preacher, you got any Bible for it? Yeah, I got Bible for it. Psalm 119, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Amen.
Now, when Jesus came to this world, I got these verses up there too. In John, something other, can't remember. In John, about 8:12. This is what it says. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Ain't that good?
Yeah.
He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, shall have the light of life. Jesus said, I'm the light of the world. But then, here's something odd. Here's something odd. Matthew 5:14, he says, ye are the light of the world. Yeah. Now, Jesus, wait a minute. You said you was. And now in Matthew, you're telling me I am. Which one is it? Well, John chapter 1 fixes that. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light.
Yeah.
Now, here we go. Y'all ready for one of my examples? When I was sitting in church, many of it, I grew up in church, and Mark, I was a typical preacher's kid. You know, I cut up like everybody else, you know. And we're sitting back there. And, you know, of course, Miss Judy, that's why we don't let Miss Judy testify. If Miss Judy could testify, Lord, y'all would all leave the church if she told me everything I did in Sunday school. But me and Mark sitting back there, and there was an older fella, and if I called his name, y'all would know who I'm talking about. He slept every service. He had glasses. He'd wear them glasses. He's a bald-headed fella. We had chairs sort of similar to these, except it wasn't cushioned. They was old wood chairs behind Trinity. And he would prop his arm up on that arm of that chair, and he would like this. Let me do it like this because of my microphone. He would do it like this, and his head would start slipping. And we was just waiting. We wouldn't listen to the sermon. We was waiting for him to slap his glasses off when he across the aisle. And he did. So his hand went up and glasses. And listen, I lost it. I'm saved, but I lost it. And man, I got a whooping. Boy, I got a whooping for cutting up the church. But I couldn't help it. That was fun. Couldn't help it. And I remember, Brother Russ, I remember this. At Christmas, birthday, whatever it was. And I don't remember how old I was, but anyway, for something, I got a brand new watch. Mm-hmm. And it was one of those, it was gold or silver, whatever. And over there at Trinity, I had them old see-through curtains over there. And on Sunday morning, man, that light comes through those windows. And that's what I figured out. I figured out I could take my watch. If you can catch that light just right. Y'all follow me? If there's any kids in here, don't do what I did. But you get that light, and you get it just right. And so he was over here, man, he was like this. Man, I got that light, that watch, that brand new watch. My daddy's up here preaching, watching the whole thing. And it come across his eyes. He'd be like. Russ, the Lord would have killed me in church. I'm doing that. And he would get back real close, you know, doze off. And man, here we go. And Mark said, we did that too. I got a whooping that day too. But this verse, John says, I'm not the light. John says, I just got to watch and I'm reflecting.
Amen.
Yep. I look like the light, but I'm not him. Yeah. But I'm supposed to be reflecting him.
Right. Amen. Yep. Amen.
So when you look at my life, I should be reflecting.
Amen.
And when I go out into this world, this dark, dark world, people should be going, woo. Mm.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
There you go.
Not because I'm anything.
Amen.
But because I'm reflecting. Because
yes.
He is everything.
Amen.
As a Christian, you see how this thing progresses. Salvation. Ain't that one? Woo! Salvation. Wonderful. But I don't want to stay on day one. I want to move and grow and learn. Oh, that's what Tim did.
Amen.
And on day four, God, let me be a reflector. When that sun shows up, let me be a witness to bear witness of that light.
Amen.
I'm ended by this. Sammy's coming. He's going to pick out a suitable number. He can just start playing whenever he gets ready. And I'm going to end with this story. Back in the old days, I hope nobody's in here old enough to remember this. Back in the old days, they didn't have lights that just came on automatically, you know. They had a fellow that went through the town and had a stick. And he'd light every one of them all down through town. That's his job. That's his job. When it got dark, he'd go all down through town lighting every one of them little poles. The little boy was up there and his mama was tucking him in. Time for bed. He kept looking out that window. He said, Mama, look at that man. He's poking holes in the darkness. She looked out the window, and it looked just like dark outside. Everywhere he lit that lamp, it looked like he was just poking holes in a dark world. Christians, on day four, can I be honest with us? We complain about the world and how it is and how dark it is. I'm jumping on me like I am y'all, but look, most of that's our fault for not poking holes in the darkness. If every Christian in this world would light up, this world wouldn't be as dark as it is.
Amen.
Now, I know there's other factors. I got that. I know there's other factors. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to be a reflector.
Yes.
I want to poke holes in the darkness. And when I walk in a room, it's not looking, oh, look at Brother Jerry. No, that can get confusing because we're reflecting the light. You say, oh, Brother Jerry. No. It's all.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's who we're reflecting on day four to a lost and dying world. I pray God will help us poke holes in the darkness in this world we live in. Heavenly Father, there may be somebody in the room right now that's just not even on day one yet. And right now, the Holy Spirit's starting to move on the face of waters and deal with their heart. You're trying to turn the light on for them. Lord, there may be some saved folks in here. They've never moved past day one. Maybe they're on day two. Maybe they're on day three, and they're just now starting to produce fruit. But Lord, help us to move and grow as Christians on day four. Help us to be that light that shines in a dark world. Help our church to be just like that. Lord, I pray as we give the invitation to somebody may mature and grow in grace and get close to you than they never have before. Lord, I thank you in Jesus' name. Won't you stand, do you think?